there. This is how it looked like when we were up there in the thin air. This is from Greenland. And as you can all see, this is what it's all about, to be able to shoot straight down to the scenery. In this situation here, it's a midday, and underneath is those amazing, beautiful mountains of ice. And there would be a great handful of shots from Greenland and this area in a while. So before you actually want to go to a workshop or aerial photography shooting, you need to make up your mind. Do you want to go in a helicopter, or do you want to go by airplane? If you choose an airplane, make sure that the wings is over the windows. This maybe sound crazy, but this is actually something that if you are a beginner, you wouldn't think too much about. But I guarantee you, when you're up in the thin air, those wings will make sure you can shoot anything. So make sure that the wings is upside, so they're on the top of the airplane. The advantage of flying with an airplane is that you can really cover a huge area. You can cover a whole coastline in 1 hour or maybe 1.5 hours, and it's fairly cheap as well if you compare the price to a helicopter. So you can cover this big area, you can do a lot of nice photography, but you can't stand still in the air. And it may sound funny, but this opportunity you have in a helicopter to stand still and bend over in the direction you want to shoot is something very, very important. And that's actually where you can move your photography even higher. You can really work in details with your photography. So why don't we all just take a helicopter and fly away? Because it's very expensive. It's cost a lot of money. It counts by the minute or by the second, and it's when the rotor is running. I will go back about pricing and all that later on, but just this is something that you should consider before you actually go out there. So what happens when you're up there in the thin air? Of course, you have to take pictures. Don't look too much. Look through your wayfinder and shoot away. I will talk a little bit about strategy later on, but as a starting point, don't waste time sitting up there and just looking. Put your camera and start shooting, and make sure that you have your four corners in place. The four corners in this is always the most important thing in your photography. You would like to have everything inside your frame. And that's the same with aerial photography. So when you're looking through your viewfinder, you will look at all four corners and you will capture whatever you see down there. Vary your photography. Don't focus too much on just one thing, because there's so much going on all the time. So you go for one place, one location underneath to you, you take up your camera, find another place. So you're working all the time, and that's the fun of aerial photography, that you're super busy. You're super busy all the time, and it's really exciting. And of course, you have the great landscape. So that's what you're looking out. Those two pictures you have right here is, I could claim that the number two picture is the great landscape, and the other one, who's a river delta, is the small wonders underneath of you. Don't underestimate those small, beautiful things underneath when you are doing aerial photography, and actually in general terms when you do photography. What should you be aware about, except of falling out of the helicopter? Stay inside, don't fall out, because then you won't make it, let me put it that way. Anyhow, rotor blades and landing gear in your frame. Since I like to work a lot with wide angle lenses, also when I do aerial photography, and you can do the same, you just need to be very much aware when you're pointing out that you don't have those rotor blades and the gear underneath of you in the frame. It's easy to get in your frame, but it's really depressing when you're looking at your pictures if you have too much all that stupid things in your frame. Then another thing, and this is regardless if it's a helicopter or if it's an airplane, do not lean on the door or anything that moves inside, because you may think that you're leaning up and you can point your camera, that this is cool, but I guarantee you it has so many small movements in this cabin, and all your picture will turn blur when you do so. We have tried more than once that our guests have been up there, and sad to say, they have been sitting up and trying to keep the camera in a position, and then it's just moving too much. Before you go up, before you start your photography, when you're on the ground, when you have time to do so, you will actually fix your lens to infinity. You put on your tripod, and then you look through the viewfinder, and you make sure it's on infinity. And then you take and glue it a little bit, so it would not move when you're in the thin air. The reason I would suggest you to do so is because autofocus it do work, but not all time. And all of a sudden, you can end up that the autofocus will go forth and back due to whatever happens in the front of you. So infinity is absolutely what you should do. Always bring a full memory card, maybe even more than one, because again, shoot as much that you can do when you're up there. Clean your lens, not even, I mean, that's a given thing when you do photography, but the difference from aerial photography to, so to speak, normal photography is that if you are on the ground and you get back home, you can say, wow, I did a mistake, you can go back very often. But when you've been in thin air, it may not happen again. It maybe would take you many years to go back to that place or afford to do it. So make sure your lenses is perfect, your camera is working, everything is top notch. Don't go up there and take chances. It's not worth it to do so. As said before, either use a fixed lens. If you have two bodies along with you, you could easily have something around 24 millimeter on one body and something around 70. Quite many times I've been working with a 28 millimeter and, as much I remember, 55 millimeter, two fixed lenses on two bodies. That's perfect for me. But do you have a zoom? Perfect. That's just as good as well. Then you can really shoot away. Exposure time, I suggest nothing below 2000. You will meet some pretty cool guys telling you, or girls telling you, oh man, I can handhold on 500 or 200 and whatever they claim they can do, I can guarantee you that some of the picture would be absolutely blurry. There is a lot of things going on in the thin air. And don't forget that you actually will be a bit nervous too, because you are literally sitting in the open. There's nothing between you and whatever is down there. So even your pulse is a little bit up and you can be a little bit hyper. So your whole body is actually a little bit tense. And then the movements in the helicopter, there can be turbulence. So exposure time should be around 2000 or even higher, depending light situation. Camera straps and no loose parts. That's how it is. Don't lose anything out of the helicopter, because you're gonna kill everybody in the helicopter. What will happen is your camera will fall out and go to the rotor blades and you will fall down. That's just how it is, so don't do that. So from now on, it's gonna be pictures from different kind of places where I have done aerial photography. And if you have any questions, please just go ahead and ask away. That could be something that you will need to like to know a bit more about. When you do aerial photography, in this case, this is the Faroe Island, you need to have a kind of a plan in place. You need a kind of a strategy. if before you take off, it's pretty nice to have a clear understanding. What would I like to do? Would I like to do the great landscape, or would I like to do the small wonders in the landscape? Just so you have it in mind, because then you will think way more about it actually. And the reason I show you this picture here is not because I actually think it's a great shot, but this tells a little bit about, all suddenly the weather was changing a lot, and this is against the sun, and I just had to get the best out of the situation. And I will get back to weather and planning later on, but in this case here, that's what the best could be done. So don't how can I put it? Don't just point the camera away if you think this is not a shot to be taken. Shoot it. If you don't like it, let it go. In this case, it won't make it to a gallery or to a book about Faroe Island. But what the heck, I can share it with you and my friends. And next time I go there, I maybe can do it a little bit better. This is also the Faroe Island. And this is shot, as you can see, straight down. Before we're talking about, I'm using very often 28mm or 24mm. This one is, as I remember, as a 70 or 50mm. And you can see it as well. It's straight down against the water and the cliff. Hanging up there, it's a great experience. And in this case, it's really a beautiful place, the Faroe Island. This is also from that trip. When we were flying around, I was thinking a lot about that I would like to capture everything, because you have all those beautiful islands and you have a lot of waves going up off the cliffs and so all that. But at one point, I was like thinking, why not just look down and take small things instead? Because the big shots of all the islands, it's not really something exciting. So this is just one of those small things happening underneath a few. And one more, this was when we crossing over one of the islands, a river going through the shadows. I love shadows. If you can work with shadows in your photography, I think you really gain something into your picture. Again, this is also from probably the same place or a little bit farther out on another island. I like this stone in the left side going down, leading us into the river. Even when you're up there, you can work with leading lines in your pictures, and it will make your picture grow a little bit when you do so. Here, it's the ice cap. Now we're in Greenland. This is shot in a really moody weather. As you can see, we spent, as I remember, probably half an hour just in the air to fly into the ice cap. And when we got to the ice cap, the weather just became very, very difficult, not only to shoot, but also for the pilot. And he had a great risk just bring us up there on that part of the ice that morning. And that's also why I think that it's important, before you do photography in general terms, is to make research before you go to a destination. You can even make your route if you like. You can use Google Map, or you can find a photographer who inspire you, a photographer that you know about, and you know that his photography is something you really like, and find out where does he do his photography. Go on Google, find it, and then find your location by doing so. This is the same day, also the ice cap up there. And going back to how to plan and make your strategy, I always plan everything ahead. I have to do so, because if I don't do that, I can guarantee you, then you can just end up in trouble when you're spending stupid time in the air. You need to have a plan in place. You need to know, where would I like to go, and what would I like to shoot? And then share those information with the pilot. you can always call up a pilot, regardless where in the world he is. If you go to, in this case, Greenland, why not just call up the operator, say, can I chat with the pilot, because I would like to discuss where we should go together. And then he can help you out, and he will let you know what is possible and what is not possible. This is also Greenland. This is in the middle of the ice fjord. This is the big mountains of ice who's just floating out. And this scenery changed from day to day. This morning or this midday, there was a lot of small pieces of ice in the water. What I like a lot, I think, is it's beautiful with all those things going on. And here again, you have all this kind of ice laying down there, and you have the mighty iceberg in the background. Talking about flying and planning with the pilot, when you're planning your photography, in this case it's the iceberg in Greenland, then there's very strict rules about how high the altitude that you may fly. Because when you do aerial photography, you will sometimes like to go low, but quite often you're not allowed to do so of international rules or local rules or regulations. Like in the US, I know that you may not fly over quite many of the national parks, like Yosemite Park and other places. And there's simply rules around that. So you can plan together with the pilot before you go to the destination. So you're not standing with the pilot and then he will tell you that's not, it will not happen. I cannot go there for one of another reason. One more shot from Greenland. Again, this ice formation in the foreground, the reflection in the water, and those mountains. Aren't they just beautiful? I really like them a lot. It's when you're hanging up there and watching this scenery, you almost feel that you can go swimming, actually. It looks so damn nice down there. It's wonderful water. But I promise you, you will less, is it, I think it's 3 minutes and then it's over. Again, also from this same area, probably some years later, I don't remember which year this was. I know that David Wilkins is actually joining this lecture. And I think it was actually from when we were flying together with Chris and David for some years back. Again, here we went low, as you can see, and shooting more straight into the ice. Again, beautiful. Yeah, so this is the last shot from Greenland, and what I would like to showcase with this shot is that, of course, it's the nature, and of course, the nature is so powerful from abroad, and also when you're doing your photography. But all suddenly, those two small boats showed up next to the iceberg, and I actually think that from my point of view, that was the best shot of the day, what I did, because it just adds something into this picture. But then again, some will claim that but this is not nature any longer. Now you put human beings into your photography, and I couldn't care less. Isn't that what photography is about? Have fun and do what we like to do. I like this, the line who swing us around the iceberg.
David says it's a 2015 Greenland trip.
Okay, good. Thank you, David. Yeah.
And we have one question from Marlene from Germany. She says, how do you cope with the cold in places like Greenland? How long are you actually flying for?
Yeah, that's a very good question. When you do photography in the thin air with open doors, because this is, let's go a little bit into the technical part of aerial photography. Make sure that if you have a helicopter, that the pilot is able to take off the doors. That means that now you will sit literally in the open air, as we talked about before, and it can be very windy and extremely cold. So when you're working up there, I would think that around half an hour, 45 minutes, that's maximum, like in Greenland, other very cold places. Even on Iceland, I will show you some pictures later on from Iceland. There it can be extremely cold, very, very cold. But dress up, use layers. I'm always wearing gloves that I can open up, so I have open fingers so I can work with my camera. And I even have thin gloves as well here. Always a hat, and in general terms, just dress up as much as possible. Because it can be very cold. But then again, I guarantee you, when you're sitting up there, you pay the price. It's so amazing. So even you're freezing, you just stick to your photography because you know this is something very fantastic. This shot here, now we went from Faroe Island to Greenland, from Greenland, and now we are in the north part of Sweden. We're not far away from Kiruna, where there is a huge national park. As you can see, I'm pretty low with the helicopter right here. You can see the foreground. It's almost like it has been shot from the ground, actually. But this has been taken just when there was a little lift. And we are going up a little bit. And the reason I'm showing you this picture as well is because that sometimes you may actually have to make a stop with your helicopter so you can share the space inside. You can be around four people shooting on the back seat, two on each side, and then one leader in the front. Those who are sitting in the back of the helicopter has actually the best exit to take pictures because there's more space, and very often the pilot doesn't want to take off both doors in the front. So the guide who's sitting next to the pilot, he sometimes only has a little window and you can't really look down or do anything. So you will sit with your camera like this and the lens will go out of this little window and then you have to shoot. And this is how I did right here, actually. I was sitting and guiding the pilot, so I could not do any kind of photography except take it out of that little window and then try to imagine how I should frame it. This is also from the same area in Sweden. And as you can see, we're pretty low again. And I think what I would like to share with you in this picture is actually leading lines. Just also when you do landscape photography in general terms, you like to have leading lines into your photography. And maybe this is not the most exciting shot, but you can have it in mind that if you can see something that can lead into the main player, in this case, the main player was the mountain and the weather in the background. So our thing, why not just use this river in a classic way to lead us into the main point in there. Also from that area, why not use reflection if it's possible? This is, as you can see, in the autumn. The autumn colors is very nice, warm. And when I was shooting this picture, I was thinking, should I increase more of the sky or more of the trees? And then, because I know for sure that I want to have the lake, I want to have the reflection, I want to have the mountain. And then when I was looking down, I was seeing all those green trees. Hopefully you can see them as well. And all suddenly I was working with those green trees as a leading line into the lake. And then you had the backdrop. And if I was a bit better to post-production, I can guarantee you we could work a lot with that. But it's just to let you know that if you can find a leading line, and if you can find this case, the middle ground with reflection, it makes your photography a bit better. I think actually David and Chris was on this trip. If that is so, let us know, because I remember, I think I was flying together with Chris and David on this day. But this is also from Sweden, from the same national park. Midday, lucky us with the weather. lucky us with whatever that is there is around that. This is a beautiful place up north in Sweden. So we're now approaching pictures from Iceland, I have been there so many times, so we could spend the whole night together just watching of aerial photography from Iceland. But due to respect for your time, then let's just keep some simple shots from Iceland. The reason I'm starting with this shot is to show you that if you have an open landscape, please don't underestimate the foreground. The foreground is so important for your photography, from my point of view. And here we have all the broken ice leading up to the glacier. We have the mountain and we have the backdrop out there in the background. This is also Iceland. This is from the mountain, from the highland. As you can see, the weather is fairly okay. I like this kind of weather where you have clouds, so you have shadows, you have highlights, and it gains so much into your photography if you have a mixed light. That's why planning is so important for you in regard of aerial photography. Quite many who have been traveling with us may not know how much planning there is for a workshop when we do this, because it seems fairly easy, because there would be a helicopter meeting us and then we would go up in the thin air and thing would be hopefully perfect. But there's many of hours planning ahead of this. And also timing, because timing is what's all about, is to catch this window of good weather. Because if it's too cloudy, then it can be too gray. It can be bright, shiny, and then there's no shadow. Then everything is very graphic. Or it would be rainfall, it can be stormy, or even the pilot will not go there due to weather condition. So when you're planning your photography with anything in the thin air, you should have at least 2 to 3 days open windows on both sides. So if you go to Iceland, make sure you have 3 days where you actually is able to go when the weather is right there. And then as well, make sure that the pilot that you hopefully have been talking to also is waiting for you and will check off when the weather is nice. Landmarkalerga, the same place, the highland. As you can see, there's this, again, I think that it's important for your photography to have this foreground, because it's kind of cool whatever is going on underneath of you. Also from this area, you can see this green stone underneath the snow, making a pattern around it. The river will go through, and then we have the smoking mountains, so to speak, in the background. I'm showing you this because now I will actually take you a little bit more close to what's going on underneath of us when we are flying. This is the next step. You can see we're going low now. On Iceland, they're pretty easy going with the helicopters. It's a little bit like Dalton City up there. If you ask the pilot, can you go there and there, and he most likely will always say yes. That is cool because you can really go close to things. You can do a lot of nice photography. On the other hand, it's also a little bit like, you know, pay a little bit respect for the nature and so on. But a long story short, there's not that many regulations. You can really go low and do your photography. In this case, we go very low in the valley, and you can see the river starts on the left side here to make colors actually. And this is what happens when you're shooting down in the river delta. All these different kind of colors will melt together, and it gives you this beautiful, beautiful pattern of whatever. This is from my point of view, where you can claim that you're bringing your photography in landscape into to kind of art in this direction. I really like it. One more shot down in the rivers. Again, I'm trying as best as possible to have four corners. When I do this, I'm trying to have something leading into the middle of the picture. Again, river delta in colors. And you may think that I've done a lot of post-production, that there's nothing done here really. This is how it looks like when you're pointing down. It's really colorful and beautiful. Again, that's a river delta melting together with another river delta, probably very close to the coastline. This could actually be the ocean on the left side. I don't remember, it's quite a while ago. I did this shot, so I don't remember, but it could be a combination of the river and the ocean melting together. Once again, they go together here. And I mean, don't they just talk for themselves, those pictures? I think they're amazing, amazing. Again, I'm trying as best as I can to have a story starting up in one corner and going down and leave us in the opposite corner, and then trying to have two corners that can frame the river in the middle.
Speaking of corners, Christian, we have one question. If you could repeat the point on the four corners you mentioned in the very beginning.
Yeah. The four corners, for me, is your frame. So when you're looking at the scenery, it actually doesn't only have to be in landscape. It can be all kind of photography. Then we need to have four corners that would lead us in to the main player, to whatever we would like to be exciting in our photography. So those four corners has to be somehow clean. It could be that in one corner you have a half house. This is a house that you cut over. In the other corner, you maybe have a wide piece of ice. And in the other corner, you have something else. So you have some busy corners. You have something that doesn't help your photography. But if you have four corners, that is clean. There's nothing that make us busy in the corners. Then our eye will just go into the center of the photography. This shot here, even that is very busy. If you look in the corners, I'm trying to have rivers who's leading us into the middle. And also in the right corner, I have an open area to lead us a little bit in. I don't claim that I'm a master in four corners, but it you can, when you're looking at your own pictures, you can actually tell the difference when you have the corners in place and when they're not in place. I may be a picture later on that is more strong and give better sense. Yeah.
There's one more question.
Yeah.
I hope I'm pronouncing the name right, from Joas.
Yeah.
If you're also shooting at 2000 when you're using lenses with an image stabilizer.
Yeah, I will. Actually, that's, as I said before, even with the stabilizer, I still see quite amount of picture be blurred, even with the stabilizer, I would say so. My answer is yes. I would use my stabilizer, but I would still go very high. And today you can easily go to 200-400 ISO and you won't lose anything in your image quality. So please do that. Yeah. So 2000, yes. Another one from this river delta. Yeah, isn't it beautiful? It's like dream away. Yeah, that brings us up again and facing into our main players. Yeah, talking about four corners, here you can see that actually, hopefully you can see that we have the wide eyes in the bottom of the pictures. In each corner, we have some eyes leading us into the middle. And in the very top, I have two corners with no nothing. So this is a way that you can work with your four corners, that you have something leading in and you can open it up. Hopefully it makes sense. If not, just I can give some other examples as well. But here it's Iceland. It's in the highland, in the mountains. I think it's in August, September, and there's still snow up there at that time. It's kind of nice. This is what it is. But the reason I want to show it is because when you are doing your aerial photography, you can also work a little bit with those layers. You know, the foreground, the middle ground, and your background. And this is just one of example that the foreground is the mountain peak. We're very close to this mountain peak. Then in the middle, you have the rivers down there in as a backdrop. And then the mountain that is like burning out, fading out in the skies. I remember this flight because the cloud was so low. So it was really not the best weather for photography. So that's why you don't have that many colors in the mountains and in the river. But have it in mind, you know, it doesn't kill your photography to have this foreground, middle ground, background, this classic way of building up your picture. Again, here, it's when I was shooting this picture here, I could either just take the camera and use the sky as my frame, and then everything would be a sky and everything would be underneath the sky. But then again, we are living in a free world, and photography has to be something that is fun, and why not just open up instead? And that's what I did. On purpose, I pointed up the camera a little bit more so you could see the sky and then the skies over the sky, so to speak. And with a little bit more time working on this picture, we can bring up all those beautiful colors in the rivers and the mountains and all that. But then again, you know, play around. Don't be conservative with your photography, even in the thin air. We should have fun. That's what it's all about. Leading lines, again, this is a gletscher. This is on the northwest side of Iceland. It was the end of the day. I think this is around 5-6 o'clock. You can see the warm color is getting there. And then what happens when you, on Iceland, places where it's fairly cold, is that everything would be a bit blue. This is the blue hour. So you have the blue hour due to it's getting colder, and then you have this the heat, not the heat, but the warm colors from the sky, and that's a very nice combination. And underneath us we have this gletscher that I'm using in this case to try to lead us up to the mountains. So that's why I wanted to have those underneath this picture. I think it would bring us somewhere. It would lead us up to these two peaks and then the sky and whatever up there. Talking about weather, when you do photography with open doors and so on, always have in mind that rainy weather is really not a go. A little bit of drip is okay. If it's just a little bit, then what the heck, the rotor blades helps you actually with that, but too much rain, forget it. Stay home and wait for better weather. And if you have this just a little bit of raining weather, and the reason I'm telling you this is because it happens so often, actually, that there's a little bit of drip when you're up there in the thin air. Then just make sure that you're cleaning your lenses all the time. Once in a while, especially when you go from one location to another because you have to move the helicopter, take your lens, make sure it's clean, so you don't get home with too many things on your lenses. Again here, this is actually the same day as you just saw before. This blue hour, and we are leading out to the ocean as a backdrop. We were talking a little bit about this. How should you dress up when you're flying? And once again, layers is a very good thing to have. Gloves that you can open so you can work with your fingers and keep yourself warm. And when is the best weather to do photography? From my point of view, I would actually say, claim it's just like here. You have some clouds hanging low. You have some beautiful light swinging in up here to the left. This is. I mean, I don't think you can get it way more better than it's right there. Another thing is that when you're talking about weather, you will always have a kind of a turbulence in a helicopter, very often actually, because you're moving around in the area and you're maybe going over the hilltops and all that. And in the beginning, I got so scared. I was thinking, oh my God, this is my last day of my life. I'm gonna be killed up here. And what I realized was that to get over that fear was to look through my viewfinder. In the very moment I put my eye in the viewfinder, I forget everything. So that's my way of dealing with a lot of turbulence and frightening in sense of too many turbulence.
There's one more question about that. Apart from the turbulences, have you ever had any bad experience due to weather?
No, never, because this is the good part of this. You will never ever be lift up those places I've been with a pilot due to bad weather. They simply don't fly. They're really cool about it. And you may have a wish go flying because you think this is okay for me, I don't care. But if the pilot of it can see any risk, there can be cloud in the air, too much wind, then he simply don't fly. Or he will change the route. So when you're planning your trip together with the pilot, what I would suggest everyone to do, don't just show up and then think, oh, he knows what I want to do. They don't, I guarantee you. The pilots are not photographers, and photographers are not pilots. So the pilot, he will just bring you up, and then he will sit there with his stick and ask you, where do you want to go? And if you don't have a clear strategy, then you can just fly around, and then you pay for it, and that's it. So you have a plan to get with the pilot, and you will also have a plan B due to the weather, because like this day, this is nice. Slide to use as an example. I wanted to climb over those mountains you can see on the left side and go deeper to the highland of Iceland, but he couldn't do that. He wouldn't do it. He said, "I will not go higher than this." And we actually went a little bit higher, and then I understood what we're all about because we would be shaking around like that. So we just took it down, and then we just went down. So my answer is that no of those pilots I've been flying with take any risk. They have kids at home, girlfriend, boyfriends, and want to watch Netflix in the evening, so they won't go. This is my last shot from Iceland, it's a more open scenery. Just to show you that of course we should do postcard when we up there to bring home and show our friend, because if you're doing too much of the small things, you may come home with a very nice portfolio, but it is also kind of nice just to have good friends over for a glass of wine and let them explore all those beautiful sceneries that that you had that very day. Hopefully I've been around as many things as possible in regard of this aerial photography. So please just ask me any kind of question you may have, and I will gladly try to answer you as best as possible.
Yeah, there were a few more. One of them, could you quickly summarize again which equipment you normally use?
Yeah. When I will suggest you, if you have two bodies, then I will have two bodies with new batteries. I will make sure that the battery is fresh in both bodies. Then I will have a fixed lens, fixed wide angle on one body, and a little tele on the other one, a little long lens. It could be around 55, 70 millimeter, not really longer, because then you actually won't have that much in your frame up there. The wide angle is beautiful for shots like this. Also, if you're hanging over a river delta where you would like to do this, we call it art photography. That's easy, but it's basically just photography. But when you're sitting in the aircraft, the pilot would move the helicopter like that, so you can point straight down in the rivers, and a wide angle really makes it even more cool, all those things going on down there. But if you don't using your wide angle, then you can use the tele lens, who will frame it a bit stronger. And then about the equipment, I would go up in ISO, maybe shoot on 200 or 400, and then I will make sure that I'm around 2000 or plus. Infinity all the time. I have my camera on the tripod. I use my zoom on the back of my camera. I'm working with Nikon, so you go live and then you just zoom in as much as you can. And when it's crisp or sharp, I take a sticker or whatever and fix the lens so it can move from that area. So and I do it with both my lenses. And the reason I'm doing it is because that when you're sitting up there, it is, you know, you're hopping and dancing and waving from one side to another, and you're very excited. You want to take all those beautiful pictures and do it as simple as possible. And if you don't do it, then you may do something with the lens or whatever. And also this zoom very often doesn't work up there. It would go forth and back, and then it won't take any pictures. And then memory card, I always have a fresh memory card so I can shoot literally as many pictures as I like, because you can always delete when you get back. Yeah. That's the beauty of digital photography. It doesn't cost you anything except that you have this delete and then it's gone. That's what it is. And if you have one body, then it's fine too. Then I would just use my zoom. And if I feel safe about it, not all pilot would allow you to do it, but some pilot, you have to ask him before, maybe, and if he's okay about it, you can change your lenses when you're sitting up there. Don't let them fall out. It can kill. Actually, it's really a serious problem that you really have to be careful. You're not losing anything who goes to the rotor blade on the helicopter. Yeah. Did I get around everything there?
No, not yet. There are two more. Is there an introduction to aerial photography like this on the workshops as well for those who have never done it before?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The way that we are building up all our workshops about this aerial photography is that we the day before, we will have a whole lecture like this, 1-2 hours, a long time that we need actually, where we go through all those things here, where we discuss more in details about as a, you know, it could be the four corners, how I define the four corners. Maybe some of you is would define them in another way, what is perfectly for me. And we will discuss technique about shutter speed. We will make sure that we as prepare as possible. And also before we go into thin air, normally we help each other with the lens, so it's infinity. So it's also a social thing that we're friends when we do photography in general terms, and in this case, make sure that everybody is safe and good before we go to the air. Yeah.
And another question was if you also do drone photography on the workshops.
No, I mean, no. There's actually drone photography is pretty cool, but we have never actually been able to run a decent workshop around it because it became very popular at one point, and then it's like it's not that popular any longer of some reason. And the last thing is that there's quite many places you cannot use your drone any longer. I think actually you cannot use it on Iceland any longer. Not many places. I'm not 100% sure, but no, we don't do drone workshops. It could be fun, absolutely. But
I might add that actually Anne is doing or is offering a drone photography session workshop on his Slovenia workshop next year.
Ah, okay, that's nice. Yeah. So. Yeah, but he has been using drone a lot, so I think he would probably just add it in on the side of the whole workshop, and that was actually what I was about to say as well, that if one of the guests have a drone along, we always play around and try it out. And but a down to earth, a deep workshop around drone photography, then it's not on my table. Let me put it that way. I'm not good enough. You wouldn't get anything out of it. Yeah.
Then I have one more question. What shoot was the most special to date for you?
Excuse me?
What shoot was the most special so far for you?
Ah, that's a good question. That's a good question. I think the first time we flew over those rivers in Iceland for many years ago, we were the first one who actually started to do photography around the rivers on Iceland. And I still remember when I was looking at my pictures afterwards, I was blowing away. Because when I was looking down and taking the pictures, I could see there was something. But when I saw them on my laptop, I have to say I was very, very surprised and very happy about it. But then again, I think all the trips have been wonderful, except if it's too much turbulence, because I'm not a strong flyer. So
that's there's tablets for that.
Oh, that's good. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's it with the questions. There are no more, perfect, as far as I can see. So thank you very much for tonight, Christian.
Thank you so very much.
To everyone who joined, you will find a lot of the topics Christian addressed tonight in our aerial photography guide. We will send out the link again after the workshop. So if you haven't downloaded it yet, you can do it then. We will also send out a link to the recording, as we always do. So if you joined a bit later, then you can see the full webinar afterwards on YouTube. And like we mentioned before, we will run workshops in Iceland, Greenland, and the Faroe Islands next year. And you will also have the opportunity for an aerial photography workshop during our trips to Namibia and Australia. So if you would like to take such incredible aerials like Christian did, then you can have a look at our website and you will find more information about those workshops. Keep in mind that due to Corona, you will receive a full refund on any workshop booking if we have to cancel the trip due to coronavirus. Okay, that's it for tonight from us. Thank you for joining. Enjoy the rest of your day or night, and we hope to see you again for one of our next webinars.